Nice to meet you as well. How'd you become acquainted with the Fox and Rob story?
Well, I got to know Fox in the process of making a short film called Alone, which was a 13-minute New York Times op doc. And I had sort of originally conceived of that film, even though it ended up being something slightly different, as a facilitation of conversations between women of different ages who were incarcerated, who were in incarcerated families and relationships. And so I got to know Fox in the process of making that film. She's briefly in Alone. And I felt it was really important to try to extend the conversation and to show sort of the diversification of experience within this issue from a familial and sort of feminine perspective.
Yeah. Was the choice to do the film in black and white just for aesthetic reasons, or was there a deeper meaning behind it for you?
I think that all of those things kind of are woven in there. There's deeper meanings. There's this, you know, there's just the superficial nature of loving black and white.
Yeah.
I think that my sort of like maybe slightly defensive, but honest answer to it is like, when we think about the history of cinema, you know, we used to make, everything used to be in black and white, and then color became an option. And as far as I'm concerned, we're still so young in the craft that there really shouldn't be standards, and we still have the option and don't even need to have deep reasons for it.
I really enjoyed the thoughtfulness in the music choices for the score. Can you tell me about the process of choosing the music for the film?
Yeah, so I actually had stumbled across Emma Hoy's music just through like a YouTube algorithm. I had a bunch of like 1970s Ethiopian playlists on my account, and I was immediately struck by the music. I loved the music. I loved that it had sort of like a, you couldn't really point exactly to where it was from. It had a real blending of genre. It had a real level of persistence to it. But then once I started to read about who Emma Hoy was, that she's a 96-year-old Ethiopian nun who's still alive, who was a prisoner of war, who was classically trained in Western music and then came back to Ethiopia to essentially create her own genre. There was something really powerful about bringing these two women together and the family with her in the film.
Were there any storylines that you wish you could have expanded upon, but you didn't have the footage for, or people didn't consent really?
No, actually, I think we got really lucky. No.
No? All right. And then from working on this, what's your biggest takeaway as to what needs to be done in our country for prison and justice reform and sentencing reform?
Yeah, I mean, that's a really broad question. And I think that, you know, in such a short period of time, I think the most important thing I think to get clear is that since the onset of the new world, we have had, this has been a problem, that this isn't a new problem, that it has always existed, that the enslavement of human life and its interconnectedness to capitalism has not changed from centuries ago. And the prison industrial complex is simply just an offshoot of that same issue. And I can give you a very quick example that Angola, you know, state prison, which is where Robert was incarcerated for 21 years, that body of land that's 18,000 acres was made up of several different plantations, which were then consolidated into a single plantation and named after the people who were enslaved from the country of Angola in Africa, and then became a prison. So we can't separate these things. And I think until we deal with systematic racism and our own history as not only a nation, but as a globe, prison reform will be very difficult.
Yeah, no, believe me, I have a buddy that works in the marijuana industry. And when he told me that the prison unions are one of the top three lobbyists for not legalizing marijuana.
Yes.
It blew my mind.
Yeah.
Like, I was just like, yeah. There's something very wrong with that in my book.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the tricky thing is that there's so many examples that we can point to, but it's like, what is the baseline, bottom line thing that is actually facilitating all of these things? Mm-hmm. And I think as a filmmaker, as someone who, you know, is not, for instance, directly connected with changing legislation, right? I'm in a slightly separate space. I can't emphasize that sort of global reality, you know, enough.
Yeah. Well, I very much enjoyed the film, and thank you for the conversation.
Thank you, Jason. I appreciate it.
Have a good one.
Thank you. You too. Yeah.